gentlemen. In a motor, squirrel cage motor, there are three windings, that is, in a three-phase motor, there are three windings, like these two are for one phase, these two are for another phase, and these two are for the third phase. So, IT current comes first there will be the magnetic lines in this direction. And second, they will be in this direction. And thirdly, they will be in this direction. So it can be seen that the magnetic lines of force is like rotating from this position to this position to this position. Again, it comes to this position and this position. So it can be taken as a magnetic pole turning clockwise or anticlockwise in a about this center point, just like a magnetic, just like in a magnet, the magnetic lines of forces act, they rotate in this direction. And inside the rotor, there are also windings done. So, when the magnetic lines of forces are active or the highest in this direction, or the resultant magnetic lines of force is in this direction, this set of windings in the rotor get magnetized in the maximum amount, and the rotor is also configured in such a way that they form a delta or star fashion of winding. By mutual induction, for the rotor to be driven, it has to be locked by means of the magnetic lines with the stator. That is why these windings are given on the rotor, fixed to the rotor. When the magnetic lines rotate in the stator, they cut the windings of the rotor. And as the magnetic flux in the rotor windings keep on changing, because the magnetic lines of force, it rotates like this, so they cut the windings one by one, and as the magnetic lines of force rotate, there is always a change in flux. There is always a change in flux in this windings. So, as by range low. When there is a change in the magnetic flux, there will be an induced EMF. So in this rotor windings, an induced EMF is produced, which running between the windings of the rotor, and as the magnetic lines of the stator keep on rotating, this rotor also keeps on rotating, because this also once an EMF is established, the rotor windings will carry a current and they also will get magnetized. So let's say then magnetized, and let's say the rotor magnetic lines are like this. So what happens now? When the stator fields are like this, and rotating, the rotor fields are like this. Now there is a gap of this much angle between the rotor and the stator fields. So what happens? The rotor magnetic field tries to catch up the stator magnetic fields, but it cannot catch up. It cannot be in the same direction of the stator, because in stator the speed at which the magnetic lines rotate is very high. This is called as synchronous speed. And the magnetic lines of the rotor, they try to catch up with the stator's magnetic lines. So what happens is that there is always a tendency for the magnetic lines of forces in the stator to cut the windings of the rotor. Now think for a situation where the winding lines of the stator, they are in same angle, they come equal to at the same position with the rotor, then what will happen? Let's say, for example, the rotor and the stator magnetic fields have coincided. In this case, what will happen is that the stator magnetic fields have totally coincided with the rotor's magnetic fields, and they have been locked. So the magnetic fields of the stator will rotate in this way, and also the magnetic field of the rotor will rotate in this way. So what happens that you can see the magnetic lines of the stator, they no more cut the windings of the rotor because it is locked. It is just like using one piece, and the many lines of forces are revolving like this. As they revolve, this also revolves. As the stator magnetic fields revolve, this also revolves in the same speed. So, in that case, what happens is that there is no difference in speed of the two. That means there is no difference in speed of the stator magnetic field and the rotor magnetic field. So, when both the speeds will be same, these lines, the stator lines, stator magnetic lines, won't cut the rotor windings anymore. So, there will be no change in flux in the rotor windings. So, if there is no change in flux in the rotor windings, no change in flux in the rotor windings, there will be no EMF. Once the EMF has dropped down to zero, there will be no current in the rotor windings, and if there is no current, the magnetic field of the rotor will vanish. Once the rotor magnetic field has vanished, this stator magnetic field cannot catch anything because it needs a magnetic field to catch up the rotor. So, what we have seen is that a quality for the magnetization of the stator and the rotor is very essential. That is why we always keep a reactive power. That is why always a reactive power is required in a motor. That means what? The current should be displaced by the applied voltage by some angle. So, in which case there will be some reactive element of the KVA. This reactive element, it helps to drive a current in the rotor by means of induction. So, these inductive properties of the windings, they give a reactive load. So, knowingly, the reactive component is inserted in the motor so that this function of induced EMF takes place and the motor can turn. If you consider for a case these coil windings are not inductive. Suppose we want to reduce the KVR, like to here, to almost be in line with the base. What will happen is that the KVR is reduced and the inductive property of the windings have reduced, in which case the EMF produced will be very less because the induced EMF will be very less, in which case the magnetic lines due to the rotor's current will be very less, and the locking of the stator and the rotor magnetic field will be very poor or very weak, and in which case the motor cannot take load. So what I've seen is that it is also essential for the motor to have a reactive load.